Do you know what a Filipino says to himself standing on wait to pay for something and he realizes the cashier is also Filipino? Here's what they're thinking. Hey, pare, what is my discount? That's right. Filipinos always looking for a discount from other Filipinos. So let me ask you, what's the biggest discount you ever received in your entire life? Well, in this episode, I'll share with you how I saved $328,000 by working at Olive Garden in this episode of the 7-Figure Squad, happening in 3, 2, 1, let's go.
Never short stopping, now I'm winning like I'm Jada. Steady through the rigor, yeah, I'm getting bigger. Just fighting in them trenches, now I'm making 7 figures like.
Bona fiesta, what a joyous day. We're so glad we came. What am I talking about? That is the Olive Garden happy birthday song. Still seared in my brain after all these years. When I left after the Marine Corps, I had my first job was a Olive Garden server, amongst many others. But I share with you how I saved $328,000 by being a server at Olive Garden. Well, before I get started, our goal is to get to 150,000 subs. So if you haven't done so already, please hit subscribe. Because once we do and hit 150,000 subs, we're going to award a church, charity, or nonprofit $5,000 in honor of our 7-Figure Squad community to help them with their thing. So please, if you haven't done so, please click subscribe. All right, let me cut to the chase. How did I save $328,000 by working at Olive Garden? Well, here's the thing. News articles floating around about the importance of going to college. And more specifically, this article about Harvard. Think about this. You're smart enough to go to Harvard. What's the benefit of going to Harvard? Think about this real quick. If you're smart enough to go to Harvard, you have to write what? ACT, SAT, whatever courses and classes and scores you need to have your entire 4 years in high school to be smart enough to be going to Harvard, and of course the prestige of going to Harvard. Imagine you having that opportunity. Well, think about this. Imagine if you can go, but they moved all the classes online. Because let me ask you a question. What's the benefit of going to Harvard? Benefit necessarily isn't going to Harvard to say, oh, I got a Harvard college degree. The benefit is what? The networking, the associations, the friends, the involvement you get in that ecosystem of what they call the Ivy League, okay? So if you were smart enough to go, wouldn't you love to have an opportunity to go to school, potentially the next Mark Zuckerberg, potentially the next Bill Gates, potentially the next Elon Musk, potentially the next Patrick McDavid? I'm sorry, he didn't go to college. He went to the Harvard Business School education side of things. But imagine if you had the opportunity to go to college there. So let's check out this article they have here on Harvard moving all their classes here because of what? Because of COVID. So Harvard Business School saying it's reverting to remote learning after beginning the semester with in-person class, citing a rise in COVID-19 cases amongst their students. All first and some second year MBA students will take online class beginning this week. Classes will take place remotely, at least until October 3rd. Now think about this. How would you feel? You are a student, you bust your tail, your parents and financially helping you go through college, you're financially supporting yourself, working, you know, jobs outside of campus, off campus, in campus. Everybody's putting their financial resources together to help you go to school, and you can't even network. You can't even learn from your professors online. Everybody's vaccinated, but still, the area of caution here, go home, study online. What's the real value then of college? So I cut to the chase. How did I save $320,000? So I didn't go to college. Because here's a crazy thing. Let me show you some data what the average Ivy League graduate earns after graduating college. Let's take a look at the University of Pennsylvania, and here's what they are making. It states the University of Pennsylvania graduates are the highest earners in the Ivy League. And by the age of 34, the average Penn graduate is earning a whopping $91,800 a year, more than the average salary of graduates from Brown, Dartmouth, Yale, Princeton, Harvard, Cornell, or Columbia. So this reality is a much different reality than I live in as an entrepreneur, as a business person. So I chose to save $328,000 by not going to college. This is something we brought up even on LinkedIn. Here's our LinkedIn profile. I talk about the from Dr. Corey Sheffield, we're connected on LinkedIn, talking about this article here that the generation of American men are giving up on college. So if we're looking at this Wall Street Journal here, it says more men today are rethinking about going to college as well. And by the way, I applaud you. What's the purpose of you going to college? What's the purpose of you looking at a 4 or 5 year college degree? And what's your major? What's really your major? What's your major? Is it English? Is it communications? Is it journalism? What's your major? I mean, outside of typical STEM, if you want to study to be a doctor, or you might be an engineer, you want to, you know, be a dentist, an attorney, of course, those specialized type of skills, of course, go to school. Last thing I want is a doctor working on me that didn't go to college or medical school. Of course I want them to go to college. Of course I want them to go to medical school. But if your purpose is to go out there and say, you know what, I just want to make a mark on this world, I want to make my money, I want to build a family, I want to take care of my family, provide for my family, why do you think that all there is to do after high school is to go to college? Outside of me going to Olive Garden to learn sales skills and dealing with human being skills and post-military, because, you know, post-military, I was dealing with PTSD and I was dealing with a world that people would say, I'll think about it and I'll call you later and I don't know, and let me check with my wife, because that never happened in the military. Listen, you'd say the yes, sir, no, sir, how high, sir. It wasn't the world I was living in when I left the military. And it was shock factor to me when people said, I'll think about it. So I learned sales skills. I learned human being skills, people skills, by being a server at Olive Garden, by earning tips. And one of my other side jobs, as I was a single father raising my three kids, one of my other side jobs from 5 to 8 o'clock in the morning was a lifeguard at the YMCA. And I used those 3 hours from 5 to 8 o'clock in the morning, and I read books. I studied all sorts of books on personal finance, all sorts of books on economics, all sorts of books on personal and self-development, spiritual development. All these things I was reading between 5 and 8, 3 hours a day, 5 days a week, about how to improve without having to necessarily spend $328,000 in a Harvard Ivy League education. I know what some of you guys are thinking. Well, you know what? Everybody in my class is going to school, or everybody that I went to school, you know, has got a college degree. Listen, I can tell you this. Being in the world of personal finance, dealing with people on a day-to-day basis, whether recruiting them into our industry or bringing them on board as clients, I see so many people out there with college degrees, master's degree, PhDs, broke, driving Uber, driving Lyft, not financially secure, safe, that they validate themselves by how much somebody else pays them a salary, or how much money they can make by turning on the signal and see how many pickups they can have in their Uber destination, Uber drives, or their Airbnb, so to speak. So it isn't just necessarily sales. It just necessarily isn't a salary. It just necessarily isn't clocking in, clocking out. And the hardest part for many of you is to compare yourselves externally. Like, you might value the opinion of other people. Like, you have so much pressure about what other people think about you. You say, no, man, I don't think about other people. I couldn't care less what their opinion is. But really, do you? Honestly, I was having a conversation with one of our guys earlier today. He was telling me, no, it's all about me, it's about me. But during the conversation, I realized, no, it was about what other people are doing, because you're comparing your success as an entrepreneur business compared to what other people are doing. Let me give you an example. I went to a funeral, and sadly, I'm going to a funeral tomorrow. And I remember as a late 28, 29, 30-year-old entrepreneur, I saw all my friends, my peers that I grew up with, or people that I knew in the neighborhood, and they're driving around, you know, Range Rovers, and they're driving a Mercedes and BMWs, and I'm like, man, what am I driving? I'm driving a broke down Cadillac Seville. I was so embarrassed of what I was driving around compared to what everybody else was doing. I drove halfway down the block so nobody can see what I would get out of, take my kids out, or after the funeral, put my kids back in and drive away. I don't want anybody to see that. But I walked up to everybody and said, hey, man, how you doing? How you doing? What are you doing? Hey, like, hey, I saw that you're doing this insurance thing, this little insurance thing you're doing. Yeah, I am. I said, what you doing these days? Oh, I'm in this business, and construction business, and home healthcare business, and whatever business. And I was just looking at them. And I was like, man, in a way, kind of envious. A little bit of a covetousness was coming my way. And I said, man, I wish I had success early on in their business. Like, what am I doing wrong? I've been plugging away at this thing for 4, 5, 6 years. How come I'm not living the level of success? I mean, I'm paying the bills, sure, but I'm driving a Cadillac DeVille with these guys who are driving around $100,000 cars. So I compared myself, which is wrong, which is incorrect. But instead of allowing myself that to drive me at that point, I was just comparing myself. And I think that's a mistake a lot of people have. They're comparing, especially today with Instagram, especially today with social media. So many of you are comparing your current success after 2, 3, 4, 5 years of being a business, of being an entrepreneur. You're comparing your success with everybody else around you. You think you need to be at the same pace they are. So here's what I learned. I learned a lot of people, for some reason, they have success early on in their career or business. But only thing will tell, that's time. Time will tell. Time will tell whether or not that decision for them or you is going to pay off. And here's what I saw through the 01.com bubble, all the way up to the real estate pickup, to the real estate crash in 08, 09. Guess what happened to them at the turn of the 2011, 2012? So many of them in their home healthcare businesses, and some of them in their construction business, some of them in the real estate development businesses, Sadly, major reversal happens, a change in the market, a change in the economy, and boom, back to square one. Worst part about that, they weren't smart with money. Instead of saving their money, recapitalized themselves and saving for a rainy day. They spent money just to show, because they too developed a attraction for just having what other people thought about them. See, a large part about entrepreneurship, a large part about where you're going in life today is about who you are and where you're going. And it may not be at the same pace or level, because here's what I realized. They were growing, boom, boom, boom. They're going like this, dang, right? They're growing. And next thing you know, without me realizing, there's another portion over here, boom, they flattened out. But my curve was like this, pah. And when they crashed, here's what happened to my business. Boom, it took off. You know why? Because I was working hard at the right things. I didn't doubt myself in this process. See this gap right here? That's the doubt gap. That's the abyss. So a lot of people in your life, you might be comparing to like this, boom, boom, boom. And you're like this, right? Here I am reading books at 5 o'clock in the morning, 8 o'clock in the morning, boom, 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 reading books, starting to learn new skills. They're just doing this, right? Next thing you know, bad decision, get rich quick type syndrome, boom. They lose everything and I take off. And I never look back ever since. So you might be in a predicament where you're thinking that, well, college is gonna make me. Nah, I'm sorry, don't believe that. And you've been in your business now for 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 10 years. And you're like, oh, I'm not there yet. Listen, man, it's part of the process. Some people are so impatient. They want instant success. My boom, 30 days later, I'm successful. Success doesn't work that way. It just doesn't. 10 years, we're reading this book right now called Mastery, written by Robert Greene. Is that oftentimes people get splintered off in so many different things, they lack one thing, which is mastery of one skill. You know, we applaud all the people today in athletics and sports and NBA and NFL. What do you think they've done since they were little? Since they were little, they were practicing. And everybody was playing, but they were practicing. In high school, everybody's partying, and they were practicing. After the game, they celebrated one game, boom, but they're back to practice, back in the gym, back to studying film. In college, same thing, discipline. So everything that you love in life today, actors, actresses, entertainment, musicians, athletes, everything you love today is because somebody got disciplined with one thing. And they mastered it. I mean, how many times do you see people that are so talented, they tried for American Idol, they tried for, what is that, America's Got Talent. And you look at them and go, wow. They're just not, it's not a regular talent show. I mean, these guys have been at it for a minute and yet they're not even discovered. So many people follow their passion. You know, you think to yourself, well, God placed something in my heart. I can't deny that. God placed a vision in my spirit that I'm about to accomplish something. Yes, you can't deny that. I'm not asking you to deny that. But it may not be necessary in the context or platform that you thought would be delivered to you. You know, growing up, I always wanted to be an athlete. I mean, who was growing up in the 80s and the 90s and you're on the 85 Chicago Bears? You're on Michael Jordan in the 80s and the 90s, early 2000s. Who didn't want to be a basketball player? Who didn't want to be an athlete? That's what I wanted to do. Everybody wanted to do that in Chicago. But guess what? I was too tall, too skinny, not strong enough. My body never caught up to my bones. And guess what I did? I enlisted into the Marines. And weirdly enough, when I joined the Marines, right after boot camp, I gained 20 pounds. It's so odd that my body didn't gain that weight while in high school. Why? At 17, 18 years old then. Most guys were looking like man-childs at 14, 15 years old, full beards when I was going to high school. But how come my body didn't catch up? I don't know. But those are the cards that I was dealt with. But however, the good Lord placed in me a vision that I'm going to be a superstar one day. I'm going to do something special and great. I'm going to have a purpose-driven type of life. I'm going to make a difference. I just never thought in a million years I'd be doing it in the insurance industry. Where today, a couple months ago, we had close to 10,000 people, the MGM Grand, the company had me flying out of the sky and dropping down in front of the crowd. We had Nicky Jam and Mike Tyson as our, and Mario Lopez as our guests at this thing. It's just unbelievable. I never thought I'd be amongst these guys. I never thought I'd be hanging around with Michael Jordan smoking a cigar. I never thought I'd meet Kobe Bryant. I never thought I'd be playing with Kevin Hart at a charity poker game. I never thought it'd happen that way. In my mind, I thought I'd be doing something great, something special around people that know. I just never thought I'd be in the insurance industry, let alone the business world. So that's the same situation for you. So here's one last data point I want to share with you guys, okay? It's the rising cost of college, because you and I were raised in a generation that said, hey, go to school, get good grades, get a good job, you'll be secure for the rest of your life. Let's stop with the go to school part. Okay, you get your high school diploma, but is it really instant financial success for you to get a college degree? Things aren't the same anymore. Look at what the cost of tuition has been since the 1980s. So when people graduated in the 1940s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, and 80s, much of your parents and grandparents were, the cost of college wasn't that bad. So if you look at the cost of college between 1980 and even the mid-2000s, it surged by over 500%. And from the mid-2000s to 2010, it surged up close to 250 more percent. So the CPI index, which is this blue line right here, the consumer price index, the cost of goods and services, that's the inflation rate. But look at the college tuition inflation rate. It's way above gas, food, and place of living, et cetera, et cetera. So the question you got to ask yourself is, can I still make a living? Am I still going to advance ahead without a college degree? And we are now in an era where, financially speaking, it does not make sense for most people to go to college. Sometimes even for many of you, socially speaking, or even politically speaking, it doesn't make sense for you to go to college based on some of the things you're going to be learning on a college campus. But that's another conversation. But for some of you, graduating college with a college degree, is it worth it for you to have $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 of student loan debt to repay that over 20 years of your life, to look to making your mark in the world, to one day buy a house, but you can't necessarily buy a house or get a car because you got this student loan debt just as a huge debt cloud over you, especially if you're only making $40,000, $50,000 a year. Here's a number I want you to consider. The average median household income, according to the 2018-2019 polls, shows that the average median household income is approximately $62,000, $63,000 a year of household income. In order for you to make $1 million, what's the math there? It takes you 16 years in order for you to make $1 million gross. I'm not even talking taxes. I'm not even talking about lifestyle. I'm just saying cumulative income. It would take you 16 years. I'm not talking about cash in the bank or you even being coming close to becoming a first generation cash flow millionaire. But think about this real quick. Because my wife and I decided to become bold. We'll talk about boldness here in a second. Because my wife and I decided to become bold and do something different outside the norm, to get involved in business, to understand sales, to understand human nature, to understand a proper service, to understand a problem that we can deliver to and solve. Here's what we realized. That in just the 6.5 years that we've been together in business, we've made over $7 million. $7 million. How much time would it take for the average household income to make $7 million? Let's do the math. It would take 112 years, making $62,000 a year, to make $7 million. And here's the solution for us. We decided to become bold and start a business together. And finally, for once and for all, control our income and fight back inflation and fight back debt and fight back all the things that comes to annihilate one's personal finances in their home. So my friends, what do we need an extra dose of? A double dose of boldness. Because through boldness, that's when you decide to do something very significant in your life. So some of you be asking about, oh, how do I become more bold? How do I become more bold in my life? How do I speak up and out? So I'll give you the advice I was sharing with somebody today. Number one, I asked him this question. In the last 6 months, who you been hanging around? Who you been hanging around? You know what he says? Myself. I said, exactly, brother. You've been isolated. Sadly, that's the cause of COVID. So many people got isolated. Video games, online, Netflix, got isolated. They thought that was okay. Unemployment checks, thought it was okay. So if you want to be bold, you cannot be alone. Which leads me to number two, get connected. So many people right now want to connect. So many people want to see one another. Sure, mask mandates, vaccines, social distancing, whatever it takes for you to be safe in this day and age, but still meet. Doesn't mean you can't see people. Here's the thing, people make an excuse, well, I can't meet, you know, COVID this and COVID that and pandemic this. Yeah, really? Really? Are you sure about that? How many people did I see at the baseball game a couple weekends ago? When I click on TV, watch Saturday afternoon college football, how many people do I see at the stadiums? Here in the next couple months, the malls, you know what's gonna happen? The malls are gonna be packed. You know what happened last year in the middle of the pandemic during Black Friday? Malls were packed. And we didn't even need vaccines last November. So please, be bold with yourself and stop feeding yourself a lot of bull crap, because you know that's what it is. So please, if you want to learn, you gotta be bold about connecting. You gotta be bold about not being isolated. We mentioned at the beginning of this pandemic, here's what's gonna happen. Either one or two things are gonna happen to you. Either you learn a new skill, you learn how to improve your current business or career, because now you've got two things a lot of people are waiting for, time and money. People are looking for time. People got money from the government, shelled out 40% of all money ever produced has been produced in the last 18 months based on these stimulus plans. And another $3.5 trillion is on the table by Biden to see if we can spend more money. We're in an era right now. You have to be bold because things are coming at you right now like a big, huge wave that either you take this wave and you ride it or you get overcome by it. But if you're not bold about it, you'll be caught up. And here's the third thing. You want to connect with a mentor that has a track record of proven success. And I'm just not talking about an online mentor. It's just not enough. there's some soft cues when you're around the person, their physical presence, that you don't pick up just on TV, that you don't just pick up on Zoom, that you don't pick up on YouTube. Be in the presence of not only that mentor, but other people learning from that mentor. And what has worked out for me to save $328,000 in college tuition in Harvard is to pick up those soft cues, the ability to connect with people, and to say, you know what? Hey, I could do something differently in my life, even though if I don't have a college degree, because I have the self-boldness in myself to say, hey, I can still get after it and not worry about comparing myself to other people. I'm bold about it, and I'm bold enough to follow through with my commitments until something happens. Before I let you go, what are your thoughts? What are your questions? What's your feedback? I want to know, what would you add to this conversation? Is going to college the end all be all for you? Do you care about people externally of you, or are you inspired internally? So before I let you go, please check out these two videos right here. Number one here, the identity shift that you need to take to become a first generation cash flow millionaire. Fantastic conversation with Anthony Trucks. You can peek out a lot of his intel and insight. Second video right here on the five traits of a cash flow millionaire. That being said, guys, if you're watching this on Facebook, please follow our business page, Money Smart Guy. If you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click subscribe, hit notifications, be alerted the next time we upload our next episode. From Dallas, Texas, I'm your Money Smart Guy, and until we meet again, continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be money smart today.